Preface of Condiments, Spices, and Flavors. Condiments, Spices, and Flavors by Mary Elizabeth Green. Condiments, if properly used, assure digestion and hasten the absorption of food by the system. Theodore Child. Preface. In this pamphlet, no attempt has been made to give specific directions as to the uses of spices and condiments. It must be borne in mind that their usage results neither from the demands of fashion nor of a vitiated sense of taste, but from their own germicidal and preservative qualities. From the spiced and perfumed mummies of the pharaohs to the spiced apple and pickled pear of our own storerooms, the same reason for the use of spices exists, their antiseptic qualities. A short account of the diverse kinds and qualities of these excellent substances may lead, it is hoped, to a more intelligent use of them in cookery. Nothing has been said about adulteration, for while most of the adulterants of spices are harmless, still fraud lies in the fact that the buyer pays a high price for an article, part of which is worthless. As every housewife cannot be her own chemist, her safeguard lies in buying only of reliable spice houses. End of preface.
Section 1 of Condiments, Spices, and Flavors. Condiments, Spices, and Flavors by Mary Elizabeth Green. Condiments, Spices, and Flavors. Maxim. As ancient as the time of Democritus of Abdera reads, whatever pleases the palate nourishes. Modern science has proven the truth of this maxim and has given us acceptable reason why condiments are no more necessary in palace of connoisseur than in hut of barbarian, why they are as eagerly used by the native of Labrador as by the swarthy son of the tropics, why they are the property of Mohammedan, Confucian, Buddhist, Gentile, and Jew of all castes, races, and civilizations. Acting principally upon the nervous system through the sense of smell, condiments stimulate the flow of both the saliva and gastric juices. They materially aid digestion, and the familiar phrase, to make the mouth water, states a psychological fact. From this standpoint, the fragrant aroma of steaming coffee and the savory odor of a stew are as truly condiments as pepper and salt, for condiments are the magic wand which transforms most commonplace of foods into essence subtle and delicious. They are equally appropriate to the steaming pottage of the French peasant and the sacrificial altar of Palestine and Greece. Nothing more closely tests the skill of the cook than his use of these appetizing flavors. Like genii of the fairy tale, they are willing, versatile, and obedient as slaves. When master their pathway, is strewn with sorrowful though most aromatic wrecks of soups and hors d'oeuvres. They should permeate food as incense does the atmosphere, delicate, impalpable, and as indescribable as they are requisite. The too abundant use of a certain condiment or spice, the lack of another, or the injudicious mingling of certain others will ruin the finest pudding, sauce, or soup ever compounded. Condiments and spices are as ancient as civilization. The oldest books of the scriptures, notably Exodus, Leviticus, Job, and the Canticles, make frequent reference to salt and spices, substances which were then costly, chiefly dedicated to royalty, and the uses of temple and altar. The Greeks followed the Semitic customs to some extent in their disposition of spices, not using them as largely in their food as having latter races. They were fond of aromatic flavorings, and it is said that the laurels of Greece, of which the cinnamon is a species, possess the ability to a greater extent than those of any other country, although all laurels have aromatic leaves. Homer, in the Iliad, refers with naive surprise to those people unaccustomed to the use of salt, and in the ninth book pictures Patroclus as he strews a bed of glowing embers wide. Above the coals the smoking fragrance turns, and sprinkles sacred salt upon the urns. By the medieval Romans, condiments were well liked. They made, according to one author, a pickle from the tunny fish, just as their langurious descendants are doing today, and as prepared a condiment from the intestines of the mackerel, liver of the capon, steeped in milk and bacalhaos, and dressed with pepper, was another of their highly seasoned dishes. In the 13th century, Dante, in the description of the alchemists and forgers of the 10th Gulf of the Inferno, referred to one Niccolo of Siena, who first the spices luxury discovered. Contemporary with him in England, William Langland, of his Vision of the Piers, the Plowman, inquired, "If thou hast in thy purse any hot spices?" Frequent reference by the writers of that day indicates that these substances were expensive and used mainly by the luxurious. Venice had, for many years, controlled the trade in spices, which were brought overland from the Orient in immense caravans, and not until Diaz and Vasco da Gama in the 15th century rounded the Cape of Good Hope did their costliness diminish. After that event, spices and condiments ceased to be regarded merely as luxuries and became as necessary to the plainest of soups as the purée de volaille à la béarnaise of the French chef. All classes of people use condiments in some form, from the wealthy epicure who flavors his terrapin with mace, salt, pepper, and sherry.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.